Talking about executive, when we focus on the organs of the government, there are three primary organs: the legislature, executive, and judiciary. What is the difference? How do they function? Very, very important. Now, in India, we have Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. Both of these are combinedly called as the House of Parliament or the Parliament. Now, this Parliament is the legislature, the law-making body. Within this legislature, we have the executive. Executive comprises of President, then we have Prime Minister as in case of India, and the Council of Ministers who take the collective responsibilities. Together, they form the executive, which, and along with that, the bureaucracy, the administrative officers, they form the executive. Executive's role is to execute, and whatever laws are made by the legislature have to be enacted, put into place. What is the role of judiciary then? Judiciary settles down any dispute that arises when the law is once passed. So, taking charge of the administration is very, very important, and that is the role of executive. Now, executive is involved with framing of the various policies, framing of the decisions, and taking those into action. Article 52 to 78 of the Constitution, Part 5 of the Indian Constitution, talks about the roles and the duties and responsibilities of the executive. So Article 52 to 78 talks about the various roles and the functions of the executive. To begin with, the system of government can be of three types. It can be parliamentary in nature, it can be presidential or semi-presidential. We would understand this in a while. But to have a broad understanding, the government can run through various ways. There can be a president in some countries, there can be chancellor in other cases, there can be prime minister in some cases, and all of these governments function in some way or the other. For example, let's cite some cases. In case of United States, we have a presidential form of government. In case of France, there is a semi-presidential form of government. In India, we have a parliamentary form of government. Then we have Japan, where again we have parliamentary form of government, but emperor is the head of the state and prime minister is the head of the government. So again, there is a difference there. Similarly, Italy again has a parliamentary form of government. In Italy, president is the formal head of the state. However, prime minister is the head of the government. We'll understand this as we move forward. So to begin with, the first form of the government, which is the presidential form of the government. All of these three forms of the government, we would understand one by one. So to focus and to begin with, the very first form, which is the presidential form of the government, focuses on president being the head of the state, head of the government, and is directly elected by the people. For example, the President of United States of America, directly elected by the people. So it has the responsibilities as a presidential candidature. Now here is a list of nations which follow parliamentary form of government, presidential and semi-presidential form of government. Important for you to note. Coming on to the presidential form of government, as we mentioned, so presidential form of government has certain roles and responsibilities in case of executive. In case of legislature, where we have the Senate and the Chamber of Deputies, and executive, where we have the head of the government, who is Commander-in-Chief. And this is a kind of presidential form of government which is democratic in nature and republican in nature. The next is the semi-presidential. Here, presidential and prime ministerial both have dual responsibility, and therefore we call it as dual executive. A good example to mention here is France. So, what is the role of the president here? President takes care of the foreign policy. So, foreign policy taken care by the president. Similarly, prime minister takes care of the domestic and the internal affairs. So, any kind of foreign affairs, defense taken care by the president. Prime Minister takes care of the domestic affairs, the internal affairs, the economic policies. That means the work is divided and there is dual executive which exists. Now, President here in the case of semi-presidential form is the head of the state. Prime Minister is the head of the government, and then we have the collective responsibility which is seen by the legislature. In case of India, we have the parliamentary form of government. Now, parliamentary form of the government is a governmental form where Prime Minister is the head of the government and the leader of the majority party. The role of the Prime Minister is to summon the sessions, to take care of the sessions and bring into effect the policies in the legislature. Now, the laws which are basically brought forward by the parliament. So, parliamentary system again works well with a democratic form of government and therefore is important. Now, when we focus on executive as our basis for this class today, executive focuses much more importance on president as the chief executive in presidential form of government. But if in India we apply that model of presidential form of government, what could have been the issues? There can be issues of the personality cult, and therefore Indian government provides a strong rule in the executive stating that to check against any kind of personality cult, we need to focus on a parliamentary form of government, and this parliamentary form of government is always answerable, and since it is answerable to the people, it is a representative of the people. Therefore, the executive functions best in the case of parliamentary government in a country like India. And with that motive, we have the parliamentary form of government in India, and executive has one of the major roles in India. The first citizen of India, the president. How president is elected, the qualifications, the oath, the duration, and more importantly, two concepts with respect to President of India are the veto powers and the pardon powers. Now, President is known for the discretion power. What is so special? President appoints the Prime Minister in India. Now, when I say President appoints the Prime Minister in India, it's by law the rule, the leader of the majority party. Now, in case one of the parties is not there in majority, there is a coalition government. Coalition government means no single party could win and multiple parties came together to form the government. So, who would be the leader in that case? In that case, who would be the Prime Minister? So, there is no one party which has the absolute majority, and in that case, President has the discretionary power to select a right leader in case of a coalition government. So that is one way where President uses the discretionary power. The second place where President uses the discretionary power is the veto power. Veto power is the power to either hold or withheld or refuse any bill which is sent to become a law. And the third important place where President uses the discretionary power is President has the right to send an advice to the Council of Ministers in order to reconsider the decision that they have done. So, three places where President plays a very, very important role, and we call this as the discretionary powers with President. So, discretionary powers of President, very, very important to note. Now, let's understand how President is elected. President is elected by both the members of parliament, which is Lok Sabha plus Rajya Sabha, and the members of state legislative assemblies, but only the elected members in all the cases, as well as the elected members of the union territories of Delhi and Puducherry. Note, in the process of election, when we have the electoral college, nominated members are not part of the process of election of the president. The next important thing is the election process occurs as a system of proportional representation by single transferable vote. That means every person is given a ballot paper, the name of the presidential candidates are mentioned, and the person has to put the preference 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 against the respective candidates on order of the priority 1 to the person, with most priority. The least ones are eliminated and the top ones, basically based on the preferential system, are selected. So this system of election for the president is indirect in nature, very, very important. It's not a direct election process from people directly. It's by the elected members of the House of the Parliament as well as the elected members of the state legislature assembly. Now, what is the qualification to become a president? The first qualification is definitely the president should be citizen of India, must have completed 35 years of age, should be qualified for election as a member of Lok Sabha. Important to note here, it's member of Lok Sabha, and should not hold any office of profit, be under state, center or local authorities. The oath for the president is taken, is administered by the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court in India. And if trying to nominate for the post of president, what are the rules to be followed? The name has to be proposed by 50 electors, and those are called as proposers, and then there must be 50 seconders as well. So 50 electors as seconders, so 50 proposers and 50 seconders, so total 100 people we can say who would be nominating the name. And once the candidature is being nominated, a security deposit of 15,000 to the RBI is made. Now, as a president, what are the conditions? The president should not be member of any House of Parliament or state legislature, should not hold any other office of profit, and the residence, which is the official residence, Rashtrapati Bhavan, would be available without payment of rent to the president of India. Also, all the allowances will be determined by the parliament. Now, the term of the president is 5 years. President has the right to resign before the term. President can also be impeached before the term. Now, impeachment can be brought either by members of Lok Sabha or by Rajya Sabha. Whatever members are bringing in impeachment from whichever house, from that house, 1/4 of the members must sign for impeachment. So far, none of the presidents have been impeached in India. In case president is not available, the post is vacant, that post would be temporarily occupied by the vice president, who would be acting as the president. In case vice president is not available, then Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, in case neither President, Vice President or Chief Justice of the Supreme Court is available, then the senior most judge of the Supreme Court would take in charge of all the duties. Important, very important to note, impeachment is a quasi-judicial process. Why? In the process of impeachment, the nominated members of the House of Parliament and state legislatures take part. However, they cannot take part in the process of election. In the process of impeachment, the nominated members of the House of Parliament take part. But from the state legislatures, the members of the state legislatures, the members of the Union Territories of Delhi and Puducherry who are nominated are not allowed to take part. So, even the elected members of the Delhi and the Puducherry Union Territory are not allowed to take part in the process of impeachment. And repeat again, very, very important to note, in the process of impeachment, the nominated members of the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha can take part for the process of impeachment, not for the process of election. However, the elected members of the Union Territories of Delhi and Puducherry who took part in the election are not eligible to take part in the process of impeachment. Must and important to note here. Coming on to the powers of president. President has numerous powers. The most important, as we said, is the discretionary power which we discussed. Besides that, emergency powers. Emergency power grant president for national emergency, state emergency or financial emergency. Each of these emergencies discussed under article 352, 356 and 360. Difference of four, that's how you remember it. Then President is the supreme commander of the defense forces of India, all the three wings, Army, Navy and Air Force. President sends and receives diplomats, ambassadors, high commissioners and therefore maintains international relations. President also appoints the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court and the judges of Supreme Court and High Court. In case of the judicial powers, President also has the pardoning power, which we would understand in a while, the five different types of pardoning powers. When it comes to financial powers, President constitutes the Finance Commission for every 5 years and make advances out of the Contingency Fund of India. When it comes to legislative powers, President has the right to summon the Parliament, dissolve the Lok Sabha, nominate 12 members of Rajya Sabha and 2 Anglo-Indian members in Lok Sabha. Coming to the executive powers, President appoints Prime Minister, Council of Ministers, Attorney General, Comptroller and Auditor General and Chairperson of UPSC in advice with the Prime Minister and therefore has executive powers. Also, the commissions of SCST, OBCs, the interstate councils are appointed by President. So those are some of the powers of the President. Coming on to the veto power. Now, as I mentioned, veto is a unique power that the President has. There are four types of veto that we discuss. First is absolute veto, that talks about withholding any bill that is to become a legislature. Suspense veto, where the ordinary majority actually can override it. Qualified veto, where a higher majority is required, and pocket veto is the idea to refuse to pass the bill. Now, under this, qualified veto in India is not seen. Qualified veto is available with the President of United States of America. In India, the President has either the absolute veto, suspense veto or pocket veto. Pocket veto of the President of India is much bigger, we can say, as compared to the pocket veto of the President of United States of America, because in United States of America, the President has just 10 days in order to send it for reconsideration. However, in India, President can use this power to keep it for a long-lasting time or a unlimited time, we can say. Now, where this pocket power was used? A very interesting case study is 1986. In 1986, Parliament passed a bill which was the Indian Post Office Amendment Bill. Now, this Post Office Amendment Bill was passed at that time. Gyani Jail Singh was the President of India. Now, Gyani Jail Singh did not wanted this bill to actually become a law. So, he used his pocket veto and just kept the bill pending over the table. After Gyani Jail Singh, we had the next president, Venkat Raman. And by the time Venkat Raman came, the government changed. And since the government changed, this post office bill, the Indian post office bill, was no more significant to them. And ultimately, this was not passed. So there is where the pocket power was used, the pocket veto power was used. So, as a part of the veto power, the President can either directly give assent to the bill, can withhold the bill or return the bill except money bill. So, for money bill, the veto power does not work. And also, the veto power does not work for any bill related to constitutional amendment. For any other bill, President can return the bill for reconsideration to the Parliament. The next important thing that we need to understand is the powers to pardon. Now, President has interesting powers to pardon. In what circumstances can President pardon? President can pardon only in three circumstances. One is where the death sentence has been granted. The next is a case when there is an offense against any of the union laws. Or third is a case of court-martial. In these three cases, President can use the power to pardon. Now, court-martial is where the military court is involved. So, there are five ways. The first is pardon itself. Pardon means let them free. So all the sentences are relieved and the convict is made free. We call this as pardon. Commutation means any serious punishment is made less serious. So rigorous punishment could be converted into a simpler punishment. We call this as commutation. Remission is where the duration of the punishment is reduced, for example, from 5 years to 2 years. Respite is where the process is very similar to commutation. The rigorous punishments are made less rigorous, but only in special conditions. For example, if a person suffers from disability, if there is a pregnant female, in those cases, respite can be offered. The last is reprieve. Reprieve is temporarily withholding the death sentence. So the death sentence is temporarily put to hold. Now, what is the benefit? Once the death sentence is put to hold, in that time, the convict can seek for either pardon or for commutation, and therefore can either be set free or could get a chance to get a reduced punishment. So those are the 5 unique powers that the president holds. So in this section, we have talked about the process of election, qualification, the powers, pardon and veto power, and the ordinance making power of the president, which falls under Article 123. Again, very, very important. Vice President of India is also known as the second citizen. In this section, we would understand the process of election, qualification, terms and powers and functions of the Vice President. Now, Vice President is elected by both the members of the members of both the houses of parliament, that is Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha. Note, the members of Legislative State Assembly, the elected members, do not take part in the election of Vice President. Why so? The idea was Vice President is mainly related to the functions which preside over the Council of the States, and therefore involvement of states is not there. The involvement of states could come only when the Vice President acts as an acting president in certain circumstances. Now, the process of election works through the system of proportional representation by single transferable vote, similar to the process of election for the president, and the voting is conducted by the process of secret ballot. Now, what are the qualifications to be eligible for a Vice President of India? Again, Vice President, similar to the president, must be a citizen of India, completed 35 years of age, but here the Vice President should be qualified for election as a member of Rajya Sabha, not Lok Sabha. In case of President, it was Lok Sabha. In case of Vice President, it is Rajya Sabha. And the Vice President would not hold any office of profit, be it under state, local government or the central government. Now, nomination for the candidature for Vice President is similar to the President. However, it is nominated by 20 electors who propose. We call them as proposers, and 20 seconders. For the case of President, it was 50 proposers and 50 seconders. In Vice President, it is 20 proposers and 20 seconders. Again, the oath for the Vice President is administered by the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. Now, what are the term? What is the term and what is the vacancy? Similar to the president, the term is 5 years. However, Vice President can resign before the term. Similar to president, Vice President can be elected any number of times, but when it comes to removal, in case of President, it was the process of impeachment. However, in case of Vice President, the process is very, very simple. The removal can occur by an absolute majority in Rajya Sabha, which is agreed to in Lok Sabha. And as soon as the vacancy is created, the elections are done to fill in the vacancy. There is no substitute in case of Vice President. Now, why vacancy are created? The vacancy, the reasons for creation of vacancy is very, very similar to as in the case of President. Either due to the demise, there can be the reasons of disqualification, there can be reasons of resignation, there can be reasons of the expiry of 5-year term. So those are some of the bases based on which the vacancy is created. Now, important to note, as I mentioned before as well, for vice president, the removal process is simply by an absolute majority passed in Rajya Sabha, agreed to in Lok Sabha. However, in the case of president, there is a process of impeachment that occurs. In case of the powers, there are two very, very important powers that vice president has. Vice president is the ex officio chairman of Rajya Sabha. What does that mean? In the parliament, we have two houses, the lower house and the upper house. Lower house or the Lok Sabha and the upper house or the Rajya Sabha. Now, in lower house, one who presides the session is known as the speaker. However, in Rajya Sabha, the person presiding is known as the ex officio chairman of Rajya Sabha. And who is the ex officio chairman of Rajya Sabha? No one else but the Vice President of India. So the powers and the functions of the ex officio chairman of Rajya Sabha are very, very similar to the Speaker of Lok Sabha. Again, a very important power with Vice President is, in case the President's vacancy is created, then Vice President would take in charge. But there is a major difference between the position of American Vice President versus Indian Vice President. In case of India, Vice President would assume the charges only until the new president is elected, is basically elected. Now, when I say in India, it's only as an acting president, we can say Vice President would work only as an acting president. However, in case of America, this is not the case. In case of America, if the president is no more in, if a vacancy is created either due to death, resignation or whatsoever reason, in that case, what would happen? The vice president would take charge of the remaining tenure. So let's say if the tenure there is 6 years, what would happen? The president was there for 4 years, and after 4 years, the president was not there. The vacancy was created. Now, for the remaining 2 whole years, the care would be taken by the vice president. So, vice president would be the president for the remaining 2 years. But that is not the case in India. In India, the vice president acts only as an acting president, and there would be fresh elections which would be conducted for the position of the president. A very important difference between American vice president and Indian vice president. Prime Minister of India, another very, very crucial part of Union Executive. So in this section, we would understand appointment, powers and functions of Prime Minister. Now, when it comes to the real executive as de facto executive, and the de facto or the real executive is who? Is the Prime Minister of India. However, we do have a nominal executive. Nominal executive is also known as the de jure executive. And who is the de jure executive in case of India? It is the President of India. So, President and Prime Minister, the first difference very, very clear. President is the head of the state. Prime Minister is the head of the government. Another important thing that you need to know here. So, head of the government is the Prime Minister. Now, how Prime Minister is appointed? Under Article 75 of the Indian Constitution, Prime Minister would be appointed by the President, and Prime Minister should be a member of any of the Houses of Parliament. It can be Rajya Sabha, it can be Lok Sabha, but Prime Minister has to be a member of the House of Parliament. Now, important to note, President, as we mentioned in the class on President, President has the discretionary power. That means in case there is no absolute majority and a coalition government is formed, in that case, President has the discretionary power to choose the leader, and Prime Minister can be actually appointed. Now, once the Prime Minister is appointed, the Prime Minister has to prove themselves within the period of 6 months as a part of one of the members of Parliament, either Lok Sabha or Rajya Sabha. There have been situations where vacancy have been created. For example, in 1984, Indira Gandhi's assassination, this was the time where the vacancy for the Prime Minister was created. However, during that time, the then President Gyani Jain Singh made Rajiv Gandhi the president, and then Rajiv Gandhi had to prove the majority, had to prove his presence within the period of 6 months. We have numerous prime ministers who have been part of Rajya Sabha. For example, Indira Gandhi in 1966, then we had Manmohan Singh in 2004, who were the members of Rajya Sabha. So, Prime Minister can be a member of either Lok Sabha or Rajya Sabha, and if there is no clear party in majority in Lok Sabha, then it's on to the discretion of the President to appoint. Now, the term for the Prime Minister is not fixed. Prime Minister can hold the office during the pleasure of President till the time Prime Minister is able to prove the majority in Lok Sabha. Till the time the Prime Minister is able to prove the majority in Lok Sabha, till that time Prime Minister would be in the office, and that would be on the pleasure of the President. Now, the powers of Prime Minister. Prime Minister has various powers. Powers are related in various ways. For example, powers in relation to the Council of Ministers, which share the collective responsibility. The idea is that the Prime Minister would allocate and shuffle the portfolio, preside over the various meetings of the Council of Ministers, guide, direct and control the various functions of the Council of Ministers, and can also bring in the collapse of the Council of Ministers if the Prime Minister resigns from the office. If the Prime Minister resigns from the office, the Council of Ministers would be dissolved. Very important to note. In relation to the President, Prime Minister advises for the appointment of Attorney General, the Chairperson of UPSC, the Comptroller and the Auditor General, and therefore Prime Minister also acts as a very important communication link between President and the Council of Ministers. In relation to the Parliament, Prime Minister is the leader of the lower house, recommends the dissolution of the Lok Sabha, and also announces the various government policies. Some other important duties furnished by Prime Minister are, Prime Minister is the spokesman of the Union Government, a spokesperson of the Union Government, the Chairman of Niti Aayog, the National Development Council, the Interstate Council, and the political head of various services. So those are some of the important powers and responsibilities of the Prime Minister. Very, very important to note, Prime Minister is appointed by the President of India. Council of Ministers is a very important part of the executive. So what forms the Council of Ministers? The cabinet ministers, ministers of state, deputy ministers together form the Council of the Ministers. So Prime Minister of India allocates the ranks and the portfolios which ministry would be taken charge by which person, and all the members of the Council of Ministers share a very important thing, and we call this as collective responsibility. And this is based on the principle of solidarity in the cabinet. That means if a vote of no confidence is passed against even a single member of the Council of Ministers, the entire Council of Ministers is set to resign. So ministry which loses confidence in Lok Sabha is obliged to resign, and therefore we say it is a collective responsibility based on the principle of solidarity. That means even if a vote of no confidence, I repeat again, is passed against any one member of the Council of Ministers, whole of the Council of Ministers is set to resign. Now, Council of Ministers functions perfectly good in case of an absolute majority. But there are problems when there is a coalition government where there are two or more political parties which together decide the leader of the leader among themselves. So what would be the problems here? The first problem is the president would use the discretionary power to appoint the prime minister because there is no leader from the party which has the absolute majority. So there would be differences. Now, since many of the political parties are joining together, there are differences in the ideology, and this differences in the ideology would not let the Council of Ministers stand together. Prime Minister cannot alone be able to decide on the various decisions. Restrictions on the prerogatives of the Prime Ministers would take into place, and also the consultation between the various political partners and political parties would become essential since there are many different political parties who are coming together to form the coalition government, and the Council of Ministers have members from different political parties, and as a result the collective responsibility becomes difficult, faces numerous problems when there is a coalition government, and therefore we say sometimes it makes the government machinery unstable. The next important element of the executive is bureaucracy. What is bureaucracy? Bureaucracy means trained and skilled officers who work in line with the legislature, and they are politically neutral. They are expected to be politically neutral because they do not take any political stance or do not stand by any political views. Now, who are part of the bureaucracy? Members who are elected through All India Services or the state services or the local authorities, and the technical staffs in the various PSUs are all part of the bureaucratic setup. So UPSC, which is the Union Public Service Commission, conducts the recruitment for the various posts, and that is for the All India Services. So selection of IAS, IPS, IRS officers through UPSC is part of it. Again, we have the SPSC, the State Public Service Commission Board, which also takes in charge of the selection of bureaucrats at the state level. Now, bureaucracy is a very important instrument which works for the welfare of the people, welfare of the common man, because whatever government policies are brought into law are finally executed and enacted on the ground by the bureaucrats. So the final welfare reaches the individual through the bureaucrats. And then we have the issue of right to information. Now, with the Right to Information Act, we have seen that bureaucracy has become much more responsive, much more accountable, and much more transparent, because any person can move in and ask about the right to information. So if the policy is implemented or not, the statistics on implementation, everything has to be disclosed through the right to information. And once the disclosure is asked for, that makes the system much more accountable, transparent, and much more responsive. So the functioning becomes much more smoother. So in a broad outline, we can say that the executive is a very, very important part of governance, where the laws which are brought into place by the legislature are actually enacted. The components of executive include the Prime Minister, President, then we have the Council of Ministers, and the bureaucratic officers or the administrative officers who actually execute those on the ground level, village to village, town to town. So this was about the executive. In the coming sections, we would understand more about judiciary. So stay tuned. Have a wonderful day ahead.